In the name of our risen Lord Jesus Christ, welcome to Trinity Lutheran Church's worship service for November the 22nd, the reign of Christ. I'm Pastor Steve Johnson. I'm glad that you were with us this morning. So let us lift up our hearts and our souls and worship together.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of power and might, your Son shows us the way of service, and in him we inherit the riches of your grace. Give us the wisdom to know what is right and the strength to serve the world you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 25th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand, and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who were members of my family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, you that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they will also answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
So today we are marking the celebration of the reign of Christ, the last Sunday in our liturgical year. So our liturgical year starts in Advent, which will be next Sunday, as we move into the Gospel of Mark in year B, and then we go through the year. This time last year, we were starting into the Gospel of Matthew. And here we finish with that wonderful parable from the Gospel of Matthew, right at the end of chapter 25. And it's an incredible piece of text that a lot of people hold dear to their hearts, especially when they think of the work we do in the church and the work that we do as individuals and as individual Christians, as people of faith. I have used this particular text when preaching and talking about social ministry initiatives. So in particular, I'm thinking of our Northern Hospitality Program that has been running for over 20 years now. The original idea of social ministry, well, it's throughout Scripture in many ways. But this is one of the ones that really drives a lot of people. And it's an emotional reaction, I would say, or an ethical reaction, is that you can't help yourself in responding some ways. And when people ask you, why do you do this? And you can quote the text, for I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty. You gave me something to drink. Stranger, you welcomed me. Naked, you clothed me. Sick, you took care of me. In prison, and you visited me. And those are the words that Jesus put towards the disciples and those that he was talking to say, here's the things. Now, how are you doing with that list? So whenever I put this together today, I went down the list and I was surprised that I got a tick mark in every one of the columns. So I was hungry and you gave me food. Well, I've been working with many meal programs for a long time. My internship was at a community center in Kitchener, and I was in charge of the food bank there, organizing it and making things happen, and providing food for the Muslim community, things that would suit their religious needs, like not including ham and things like that. Today, I am the chair of St. Paul's Social Services down at St. Paul's Cathedral in London here. For years, this program has been going on, and I'm really glad that I've been able to be a contributor to the success of that in recent years, and especially in this last 7-8 months of going forward. I don't do the work, but I'm helping organize and promote the staff and the volunteers who are there. Initially, when I came on board, I was down there on Friday mornings actually preparing meals. I loved it. It was great fun. For the thirsty and you gave me something to drink text, my favorite story would be organizing a fundraiser where we sent money to the Olive Branch in Tanzania. And they actually built an irrigation system Not so much for drinking water, but it was to get the water out for the plants. So the plants were thirsty, and we managed to help them, give them something to drink, which fed them instead. So those first two kind of go together, but that whole idea of we need water, and when it's absent, it's really important that you get it. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. We brought a family in from Syria. And yeah, I was a part of the leadership of that to make that happen, and was very pleased that on that June day a few years ago, I was able to drive down to Toronto and actually greet them and drive them back to London. I welcomed them in a very physical way and in a leadership way with the congregation here. For the line, I was naked and you gave me clothing. I've done that. I've saved up clothing. We did that sweater drive for Afghanistan a few years ago. More recently, I organized with the confirmation class the massive sock drive, and they reached over 200 pairs of socks, and we took them down to the mission store. So their feet were naked, and people got socks that winter. I was sick and you took care of me. Well, I've done that too. I've been a hospital chaplain in my training. I've been a hospital chaplain when I worked in St. Peter's in Broadhagen. I was part of a cycle where the pastors went down and for a week, and they would go down and visit the people in the hospital, just randomly showing up for whoever was there. I also visit our parishioners in hospital, but that's kind of what I'm supposed to do as a pastor. But this other part was being the chaplain in a hospital. And people were sick, and I took care of them. In my internship, I was in the cardiac ward at St. Mary's Hospital in Kitchener. And I remember going around and seeing these 80-year-olds with their little red blankets clutching them to their chest, and them all getting a lease on a new life. It was a fabulous experience. Now, the last one would make you ponder, but I also have had that opportunity too. So there used to be a psychiatric forensic unit in St. Thomas, and there was a gentleman I used to visit there on a regular basis. So it was a prison to some degrees. When you got there, it was all locked down, and your visit was monitored and carefully controlled. And it was an intense experience. But yeah, I visited a guy who was imprisoned, and I visited him and brought a word of hope, a word of the gospel, and brought the communion elements to him all the time. So I've done pretty good. I got those all down there. How about you? Have you managed to tick off some of those boxes? Well, this is not a competition. Not ever a competition, because as soon as you put that up as a competition, I just think of Mother Teresa. She dedicated her whole life to this kind of thing. I do it in part of who I am as a Christian. I do it in part as who I am as a pastor. But there's people who excel in this kind of thing. And remember, this isn't a competition. It's not you've got all the boxes ticked off, or you need so many of them ticked off before you get your reward. Doesn't work that way. And also, we as a congregation, it's a good measure of the things that we do. But again, it's because we're called into it. This is emotions and ethics, where we all can't help being there. For me, I'm always moved by going to the Northern Hospitality Program when Trinity's there serving, and seeing the people I know and love dearly out there serving and giving strangers food, giving people what they need. But it's more than just within our hearts. It's more than just ethics. It's more than just emotions. This text drives us to a very deep theological position. So when we go through that list of hungry, thirsty, etc., down to the imprisoned, and the righteous ask, when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and we visited you? And the king said, truly I tell you, just as you did it to the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. Here's the theological driver. If we truly believe in the incarnation, and we are about to move into the season of celebrating the incarnation, when Christ comes down to us in flesh and moves into the neighborhood, Jesus is part of who we are. He's not a deity that's distant and remote, where he says, go look after those people, my people. Jesus is part of us. Jesus is within us. And there's multiple texts within our scriptures that remind us that Jesus is part of us. And if Jesus is part of me, Jesus is part of you. And if Jesus is part of me and Jesus is part of you, Jesus is part of that person over there. So the one who comes and irritates me and knocks on my door and says, give me money because I need help. I have to remember, Jesus is within them. Christ is part of who they are too, even if they don't recognize it. So we're driven by this idea that when we look after others, we're looking after Christ. And we don't look after others, which is the downer side of us, we are not looking after Christ. Just to add some judgment and weight to the whole thing. But to tell you the truth, even though this is a judgment parable, I think this is more about mercy. I think this is more about seeing Christ in others, greeting the Christ in others, feeding the Christ in others. I know that drives me when I'm at those hospitality meals and serving people and visiting with them and helping them out. There's a Christ in them, and that's who I'm serving. May the Christ in me meet the Christ in you is the thinking that I take with me in those. But there's another aspect to this as well. This is not just ethical. This is not just theological. This is also political. So 4 years ago, 2016, November the 13th, I preached a sermon here at Trinity, and it was following the election of Donald Trump. And I talked about the fear, I talked about how concerned we were, because there was a lot of talk back then about what's going to happen if he gets in. And most of us got it completely wrong. We thought, that will never happen, it's just too crazy. Well, 4 years later, it's coming to an end. But I'm going to quote myself about that day. I didn't say that God needs to take action on this and do something. What I wrote was this: that God's plan will be revealed. How? Well, I don't believe it will be with supernatural events to correct or even avenge the world, but rather it will be our witness. Our witness of what God is up to. What God is up to with the person of Jesus Christ. What God is up to with the person of Jesus Christ who came down in love, who came down in God's love for a broken world. That is how God corrects, using the righteous to testify to Jesus and his love. And that's a direct quote from my sermon from 4 years ago. But really, what I'm saying is that is God's reign. That would have been a perfect closing for a sermon 4 years ago for the reign of Christ. I don't remember what I preached that particular Sunday, but here it is today, 4 years later, and we have given witness to what God is up to with the person of Christ who came down in love for a broken world. This is also political, and not just in my view, but also the text that we have today. It's Matthew chapter 25. But just wind forward, just a fraction, five more verses from the end. So this is the beginning of chapter 26, the first five verses. When Jesus had finished saying all these things, he said to his disciples, "You know that after 2 days the Passover is coming. The Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified." Then the chief priests and the elders and the people gathered in the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, and they conspired to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. But they said, "Not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people." That's the setting that this parable of the sheep and the goats preludes. That's a very political thing that's about to happen. The religious authorities don't like what Jesus is doing. They engage the Roman authorities, who don't like what Jesus is doing. That's political. And that's who ended up actually bringing about what they said they would do. They would arrest him and crucify him. And they were even concerned about, well, don't do it during the festival of the Passover, because that will incite people to riot. Does that sound like modern politics? Well, yeah, you can really picture that happening. So yeah, this is very political. And Jesus says so himself. If you look back at the very beginning at chapter 25, our reading for today, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, Jesus was saying, the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him. Did you catch that? All the nations. He's not just talking about the people of Israel. He's talking about all the nations. Everyone will come before the king, and these questions will be asked. When I was hungry, when I was thirsty, when I was a stranger, naked, when I was sick, when I was in prison, did you look after me? That's the question that's going to be asked of all the nations. So while this started off being emotional and ethical about where do I fit in, have I done these things, really, this is directed at the political world of the nations. So I'll go back to what I said 4 years ago. I don't believe that it will be supernatural events to correct or even avenge the world, but rather it will be our witness. This is how we participate with our faith that is driven by an incarnational depth of theology that Christ is within us, that we drive to witness to our governments, to our politicians, to the nations, to say, look after the hungry, the thirsty, the stranger, the naked, the sick, those imprisoned. That is the reign of Christ coming to the world around us. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, thunder the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what
Longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all in need. Sovereign of all, train our ears to hear you cry in the needs of those around us. Bless all social ministries of the church through which we seek to serve others ourselves have been served. We pray for all of those suffering in these pandemic times within our towns and cities, especially those in nursing homes, within our provinces and territories, especially in Nunavut and other isolated communities. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. You cause rain to fall on the just and unjust alike. Direct our use of creation to provide for the needs of all people in ways that are sustainable for the earth. We give thanks for international organizations that focus on healing and caring for the world you have made. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Bring peace to every place where conflict rages, especially the people and politics of the United States of America. Grant opportunities for ending divisions among them and usher in your reign of unity and reconciliation. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Heal the sinful divisions we erect between us and release us from systems of oppression and prejudice. Restore our capacity to see your image in those whose dignity we have stripped away. Heal the sick and recovering, and give hope to those within our congregation. Today we pray for Lauren Keller, Monica Spilsbury, Susan Okanon, Gunther Sturm, Lou Mantle, Marg and Don Cook, and Mary Ann Stewart, and those close to our congregation, Deborah Kenny and Bobby Mantle, daughter and son of Lou and Sharon Mantle, Al Barrett, husband of Carol, Jack Kells, son of Madeline, Steve Hodgins, son-in-law of Linda Reynolds, Richard Jackman, husband of Nancy, and Frida Paler, friend of the congregation. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Pour out the gifts of your Spirit on children and youth throughout the church. Sustain those who work in children's ministry, youth ministry, and campus ministry as they nurture the gifts of young people. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. This week, we pray for those in the Thames ministry area, especially Pastor Catherine Gome and the members of Redeemer London. We give thanks for all those involved who feed the hungry, especially the Trinity volunteers who have supported the Northern Hospitality Meal Program. In these pandemic times and now winter times, we give thanks and pray for those that are able to continue supporting the Northern Hospitality Meal Distribution. The people at St. Paul's Social Service and all of the meal programs in London, help us, Lord, to always see your presence within those in need around us. Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. Amen.
Together with the church around the world, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As our offerings arrive at the church via the mail, like people dropping things off, or over the internet, we give you thanks to God for the offerings that our community brings. Let us pray. Providing God, we return these gifts to you, our time, our talents, our treasures. Use them and use us for the sustaining of your ministry through our Trinity congregation to share the good news and to glorify your holy name. Amen. Let us pray. Praise and thanks to you, Holy God, for by your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
By your word you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness. Forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God, rekindle your gifts within us, renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray with the words that Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the Lord bless you.
May the Lord bless you.
May the Lord keep you.
May the Lord keep you.
Make his face to shine.
Make his face to shine.
Shine upon you.
Shine upon you.
And may he be gracious to you. And lift up his countenance to you. And give you peace.
And give you peace.
And give you peace.
And give you peace.
For